Piggies.
330 miss.
I like pigs.
Enough said. Welcome to Inside Dr. Herman's Head.
Welcome.
My name is Dr. Jan Herman.
It
and,
is.
And it's been confirmed. I am he of the Herman Chiropractic Center in Stroudsburg, Pennsylvania. I'll give you that phone number once. You don't call it now, though. 570-424-LIFE. Because I'm not there. I'm not a chiropractor tonight. Tonight I'm a radio celeb.
Celeb? When did you surpass me?
I didn't say I surpassed you. You're twice the celebrity I am. But
I didn't even know that.
What makes
Thank
a celebrity? You. Here I am on the radio. That's all it takes. I got more than Kim Kardashian going on. And I got it all going on. This is Poker 96.7. It's Sunday night. It's just slightly after 7 o'clock as usual. But
whole lot about nothing.
Plus a little bit more.
And some of that.
This is a call-in show. We ask you to call into the headline hotline at 570-420-9670. But we ask for one caller per show, per listener. Please, if you have a lot to talk about, then call us later on in the show, second half hour preferably, and we will talk about all the stuff you like to talk about. I would like to mention that tonight we have a couple of giveaways.
Yeah.
If you would like any of the things that we are giving away, then give us a call, and we'll see if we can hook you all up.
Prize time.
Tonight we're giving away two pairs of tickets for the Alive 75 show.
Yeah, man.
Which is a Kiss tribute, and I was watching some videos of them. They're really good.
No, they're awesome. I know my brother went last year when they played the Sherman last year, and he was bugging out. He loved it.
Yeah,
yeah, because they're just recreating, because they released that was their live album, live. Mm-hmm. And yeah, they're just like recreating that whole thing, like word for word.
They're very, very good.
I mean, they got the whole stage set up and everything. They got a big light up Kiss sign behind the drums and everything, just like the show. Like,
you know, I wasn't going to talk about it, but I want to take 2 minutes to talk about this.
All right.
I remember back in the 80s.
Okay.
Going to Beatlemania.
Okay.
Okay, in New York. And it was the first really big Beatles tribute band.
Yeah.
And it was a Broadway production.
Yeah.
It toured around the world, but it was in Broadway for a very long time, and it did very, very well there. And the funny thing is, even though you knew it wasn't the Beatles, you also knew it was the closest you were ever going to come to actually seeing them perform together.
Well, especially if you didn't see them before. Yeah, there was no more Beatles. So.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And I was talking to Terry, my wife, the other day, and she's because I was talking about this Kiss show, and she said, "But you know, it's not Kiss." I said, "But you're not going to see Kiss right now."
Well, no, they're touring.
Well, okay, they do tour, but the thing
but
is,
you're not going to see Kiss from 1975. And that's what this is.
Exactly. And also, you may not have the money to see Kiss wherever they are.
Right.
They may not come to your town. Mm-hmm. You know, there are places in this country where people live 7 hours away in a drive from any kind of big city.
Yeah.
You know the places where Trump voters live. And you might not ever get the actual chance. So if they come to a smaller town like Stroudsburg and play a place like the Sherman Theater, it's your opportunity to see them. Okay?
Right.
In quotes.
Right.
They have lots of it. And some of them are very, very good.
Look, man, I'm a fan of tribute bands. This is the way I look at it. People are like, oh, just cover bands and stuff. All right. Whatever. Are you a fan of that music? Yes. Do you like those songs? Yes. Go out, have a good
Enjoy
time.
Enjoy it. Exactly.
Just go out and have a... Like, one of my favorite bands, The Misfits, okay?
Okay.
They just reunited with the original members and played only two shows a month ago.
Uh-huh.
For the first time in 30 years.
Okay.
The original bass player now kept the band going with like new members, and he started singing for them and stuff like that. And people were always like, I can't go see that version of the Misfits. It's not the real thing. Like, he's still playing the same songs. It's like a Misfits tribute band.
Right, exactly.
That's the way I look at it. And every time I've seen him, I've had a blast every time.
It's almost like the real band doing a tribute of themselves.
Right, good. I don't want to see you at the show then. I'm going to have a good time exactly. without you. You know?
Well, now this is the thing. It's really weird. I went years ago. It was about 15, 16 years ago on my first trip to Paris.
Okay.
First time I was there.
Paris is nice. I like
Paris
it.
Is beautiful. It's a great city. And I was with my brother. I was with my kids and my brother and his kids and his wife. And the funny thing was we were there for about 7 or 8 days and it just poured the entire time. It was terrible, terrible weather. It was an April trip. But we went to the Louvre.
Okay.
Now, I look at art this way. I'm a very practical person about anything historical.
Okay.
For instance, you know I'm a Titanic buff. I love the Titanic, the whole story of the Titanic. I've talked about it several times. But the one thing that I was always interested in about the Titanic was what? Do you remember?
I don't.
The iceberg.
Okay.
Yeah, I want the, where's a picture of the actual iceberg? Okay. You know, that's what I want to know. I want to see stuff like that. Not the things that they talk about all the time that people know about.
Yeah.
I want to see the side stories.
You don't want to hear about the how the ship was a failure to begin with anyway. You
well,
want
to I mean, but there's, you can hear about that ad nauseum.
The iceberg's the killer. That's what it killed everything.
And it was such a thing. And it was so odd. It was a rare thing to have the iceberg that far south. So I want to see a picture of it. Apparently, it was gone by the next morning because there's no picture. But there is a picture. They think it was that one. But okay, whatever. I digress. Okay. Now, at the Louvre in Paris, you can see all kinds of originals of things that you've seen reproductions of for years.
Mona Lisa's in there.
All right. Let's talk about the Mona Lisa, okay? Now, you have seen the Mona Lisa, the image, 720,000 times in your life.
Right.
Okay. And in not just
seeing, like an 8x10.
Okay, now that's the thing. Like whenever you go to a cheesy, no pun intended, Italian restaurant, they always have a fake copy of the David outside.
Oh, yeah,
okay?
Yeah.
Or the Venus de Milo. But my question was always like, how big are the actual statues? Like how, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
You may go to Vegas and you may see the reproduction of the Eiffel Tower there or the Chrysler Building or whatever, but you say, well, how big is the original? If you've never seen it. So I'm interested in things like that.
Yeah.
So we went to the Louvre, and I said, I want to see how big the Mona Lisa was. And I saw a bunch of the other statues, too, and I saw the size that they were. So Rodin's is thicker at the museum, and it was pretty big. It was much bigger than I thought. But the Mona Lisa, I was really interested in how big is it actually. And, you know, the Louvre.
I didn't really, like, go in there, but I was hanging outside.
Okay. It's nice looking from
it is
it's
cool,
a gigantic building.
Yep.
If you think it's big from the outside, walking it inside, I felt like I was walking back to New York. It was just tremendous.
Yeah.
The hallways go on forever. It's like going to Versailles, the palace. Mm-hmm. So big you can't even imagine. And we're walking, you know, and boy, I'll tell you, they got a thing about Jesus there. They got paintings.
All Europe's got a thing about
Jesus. So paintings of Jesus and the Madonna and the whole thing. Yeah. So we look at all these, I mean, literally thousands, tens of thousands of pieces of art. And we finally get to the room where the Mona Lisa is. Now, the room is the size of a very large college gymnasium.
Yeah.
Big. Very big. And in the middle of the room is a wall dividing the room in half. And you can actually, like a tennis net.
Yeah.
That divides the court. And, of course, it goes all the way up to the 25-foot ceiling.
Yeah.
But you can walk around
both
sides.
Walk around it, yeah.
Right, just like the net on the court. And there's a semicircular rope. The only thing on that middle wall is the Mona Lisa. It's all by itself. And the interesting thing is, if anybody else is interested, I don't know, it's actually about 16 by 20.
Is that what it is? Yeah.
Yeah.
I
so
knew
it's
it was
not
small.
Very big.
No.
But it's about the size of if you've ever seen the Declaration of Independence, it's about the size of that.
Right. Okay.
But the thing is, there's a rope that keeps you away from it at the closest point by 20 to 25 feet.
Right.
You can't get near it. But you can see the Mona Lisa. It's right there. And my brother and I walked in. He had been there before. And I walked in. And there were about 100 people. Like people, in, you know. And everybody's staring at it. It's kind of quiet in the room. And I looked at it for a couple of seconds. And he looked at it. And he looked at me. And I looked at him. And I said, he says, what do you think? And I said, truth? And he said, yeah. I said, I don't believe it.
You don't think it's legit?
Nope.
I've thought about that myself, actually.
I said to him, why? Now, it has already been stolen several times and recovered several times. Why would you take a chance on exposing it to theft again when so many reproductions are so perfect as to fool experts? And you don't even need a perfect one because it's 25 feet away from the closest pair of human eyes. Put a cheap poster of it in there.
Yeah.
And he said, good point.
I mean, but
we turned around and walked away, and that was the end of that.
I mean, but then they could get someone in there. Well, I don't know. Were you allowed to have cameras in there?
You know what? I don't think you were. My memory tells me no, but
Because I was going to say,
why not? What's the big deal?
Like I was going to say, get someone in there with like a real, because you could get found out that way. You get a nice camera in there with a real nice lens, zoom in on that, check out textures and stuff. If it's a poster, you're going to see it's a poster. You know, like
it doesn't matter. You've got what they're selling you is the experience of seeing it.
I understand that, and we could talk about this forever because I tell people all the time you should support the arts, like of all sorts, music. I'm talking about, you know, hey, pay for it, man. These people work. You got to buy music. You got to buy artwork when people make it. You got to support it. But I don't understand what makes why. Why is that thing so popular? Why is that thing worth so much money? Why is it?
I've asked many artists of many different media about this.
I mean, she's not even pretty.
She could have been really hot at the time. Yeah, she could have been all there was.
True. I mean, you know.
But what I can tell you, I've been told by experts as far as the valuation of art.
Yeah.
Of course, visual arts are different than audio arts.
Mm-hmm.
Okay,
oh, yeah,
you know what makes you know a song better than another song? You can, okay, and plus there is the objective, you know, what you like and I'm sorry, the subjective, what you like and what you don't like. But as far as you know, what makes a painting valuable or not?
Yeah,
especially abstract, which you go like an elephant could paint that, and somebody's like, hey, he did, no, you know,
yeah. An elephant did, isn't exactly. That amazing? $50,000, please.
So what you know, and the interesting thing, if you look at like a Van Gogh. Or a Rodin, or a Monet, or a Manet. Okay,
I know this too. All right, yeah.
And you go, well, they took months and months and months painting this little visual thing.
I have artists that paint. I have friends that paint and stuff like that. And I know a lot of tattoo artists too. And they sell their stuff. And yeah, it's worth money.
They put a lot of work into something like that.
Right, and I agree. You should pay for this work of art.
Well, there's a lot of. Let me get to my point. Yeah. There's a lot of detail. Then you get an artist like Jackson Pollock with just a bunch of splashes on a
piece,
okay?
It on there, yeah.
And that may take him all of a half an hour to do. Or some other dude where it's just a big white square in the middle of a black background. I don't know, whatever.
Yep.
And they can say that is as valuable as a Van Gogh.
Yeah.
Or a Rembrandt or whatever. And when I've asked these experts, you know, about it, the very, very best answer I've gotten is there is no objective way to explain the value of one over the other. It's whatever the market bears. Rarity is something. Or if the artist is dead.
Yeah, I understand rarity on certain things.
But Jackson Pollock is dead and so is Michelangelo.
Yeah.
So what makes one more expensive, more valuable than the other? It's what the money. If the Mona Lisa tomorrow couldn't be sold to anybody on the face of this earth for more than $1.80, then that's what it's worth.
Yeah.
So that's all it is what the market will bear.
So that's it's like anything else.
Why is a pair of sneakers $150 as opposed to $19.99 at Walmart? It's what the market will bear.
It's like anything else then because you know same thing with like you know why is this comic book $1 million and why is this like,
exactly you know? Rarity is definitely something you can measure.
With artwork, there was something else going on like because. I just didn't get it.
No, it like, really why, isn't. Why it's not like they're like the paints used had 24 karat gold in them.
Yeah,
although some do. That doesn't make it more valuable just because of that.
Yeah, I mean, like, oh, this thing $375,000 hanging on my wall. Like, really? Why? I don't. You know, that's what I.
Yeah, and you go, and you might say, well, I wouldn't give you more than $10 for it. You know, and that's what it's worth to you.
And that's what it's worth to me. Yeah, no, I get it.
The point of what I'm saying is that I have seen originals, both art and performances where I thought it wasn't as good or it just wasn't good.
Yeah.
Or, and you know what? I've actually, and you've also, everybody has, heard a songwriter perform their own song.
And it's not, oh my God.
And you don't like it as much as the popular version.
You know the biggest one for me? Bob Dylan. Sucks. Hate him.
Right?
Hate him. Now, all right.
I think his voice lends itself to some of his songs really well and some not.
But the guy is a hell of a songwriter because people will cover his stuff and they are jamming tunes.
Some of the songs are done in so many different styles.
In different styles, too. That's what I mean.
That it like, lends itself. And that, I think, is a sign of a quality song, too.
Incredible songwriter. But when the guy's doing them himself, man, my ears are bleeding.
Right?
I can't do it.
Gosh. I've had a couple of those too, but anyway, so the Kiss, get back to what we're talking about. The Kiss Alive show was a very good show. They're a really, really good impersonation band, tribute band. And we have a couple of pairs of tickets to give away to. So it's Saturday night, a week from last night. It's
Saturday coming up.
The 19th, am I right? Yes, the 19th.
Yep.
Don't know what time the show is. I think it's 7.
I think most of those things start around then.
So if you want tickets for the Alive 75 show, give us a call. Also, we have a 4-pack for Gorilla Grove over at the Kalahari Resort, which is the Gorilla Grove Treetop Adventures. They just recently opened this thing. You hear about this?
Yeah, I was looking at that.
You do like, there's like 87 elements over 6 courses, and it all takes place on the tops of the trees.
Yeah, that's pretty cool. Zip lines and stuff?
Zip lines, and you walk on tight ropes, and you slide on platforms, and no deaths yet. Nobody's gotten hurt that we know of.
Win these tickets. You could be lucky.
You could say that you survived it. And they're good, I'm told, till the end of the season. I don't know when that is. But if you want to go up at the top of the trees in the cold, although it hasn't been that cold lately, give us a call and maybe you can be a gorilla for a day. Do we have a caller?
We do. Let's get it.
Okay. Welcome to Pocono 96.7 inside Dr. Herman's head. Who do we have tonight?
Hello, Dr. Herman.
What's happening, my friend?
JFB.
JFB.
What's going on, Jeffrey?
How you guys been?
Pretty good.
Good. How are you?
All right, we're fine.
What do you think of Kiss? Were you a big Kiss fan?
No, I was not.
Really? I would have picked you for a Kiss fan.
No.
Okay.
I was into the Allman Brothers.
Okay.
Chicago.
Okay.
Because I like brass, you know? I like the brass.
Yes. I hear you.
Okay. I was into the Chicago. I had Doobie Brothers and all that, you know, all them.
Gotcha.
But, No, not so much Kiss.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, they were...
The makeup scared you, huh?
I was trying to get that out.
It gave you nightmares?
Yeah, that was scary.
Gene Simmons did give me nightmares. When I was a kid, like, I would stare at the first album cover, my brother's records, and I would get scared, but I couldn't look away. I was like, look at these guys. You know what I mean? I've never seen anything like it.
Yeah.
Well, you know what? Right? The first time somebody told me that the 4 guys who made up Kiss were all Jewish guys from Haifa or from Tel Aviv, I was like, is that what's running around Israel?
I think, isn't his name like Chaim or something like that?
Chaim Weitz.
Yeah,
Chaim Weitz. Yeah, you got like a dachach in there. Yeah, Chaim Weitz is Gene Simmons. And so I was like, you know what? I never saw anybody with the kind of makeup of my synagogue, but... Yeah, they're out there.
That was a good conversation you guys had with Paris. I've never been there.
Oh, Paris is a beautiful city.
It's a great place, Jeff. Yeah, it's a great place.
And yeah, I'll tell you something, Jeff. A lot of people stay away from Paris because they're told, they got the impression that the Parisians, the French people, are not nice.
Well, I've encountered that personally myself.
I thought they were nice, the ones that I met.
The ones you met. I mean, like, if you were in the middle of Paris and, like, I mean, it's tourist friendly, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, with my situations, I've dealt with French police. Didn't like us very much.
Well.
They actually told our driver, our bus driver, because he was Dutch, so he spoke French and all that stuff, too. And they told him, this is what you get for driving Americans. Now your American friends are going to know the meaning of French justice.
Really?
And they gave us all tickets and all this stuff. And it was stupid. They pulled us over for nothing. And
tickets are one thing. I wouldn't want to lie.
No, pulled us over for nothing, and it was just really stupid. But
well, that was his personal opinion.
Yeah.
Yeah, but when he's got the...
He was a nut job.
When he has the keys to the handcuffs, you got
it. Well, no, it was two lady cops, 2 women.
Really?
Yeah.
Ooh la la.
Yeah.
Oh, man.
I'd like to be handcuffed by them.
Well, you know.
All right, don't cut me off. Don't hang up on me, Gary. I love you, doctor.
Oh, my God.
Gary's not behaving.
All right,
Jeff.
All right, guys.
Jeff, we're going to run, man. It's good to hear from you. Have a great weekend.
See you again.
You too, dude.
I'll talk to you next Sunday, all right?
Sounds good.
Later.
I love you guys, man.
You too, buddy. That's funny.
JFB.
Yeah, France was nice. I had a good experience in France. What time is it? Oh, really?
It is.
Wow.
Yeah, that was quick.
What is going on?
I don't know. It was a good convo.
Bud, we need 2 hours. That's what I can say. We need two hours. I look up. I just want to talk about one little thing. All right, we'll take a break. I want to talk about Thai Orchid again because Thai Orchid is my favorite Asian restaurant in the Poconos.
I'm due for a visit.
Yeah, me too. And you know what? Actually, tonight I actually had a craving.
Which one?
I had a craving for the meat crab.
Oh, that was good.
And I'm going to tell you people that to go down and call before you go if you want meat crab because they don't always have it, and they'll hold it left. It's a mound of crispy rice noodles, and it's the you know if you ever see the ones they drop it in the oil on the wok,
real quick and it explodes.
Really, really good. It has that crackling, and they put peanuts and. And peppers in it and scallions, but the sauce that they put on top.
Yeah, the sauce. Like I'll say it constantly all the time. Just the flavors of these sauces blow me away.
it's like a sticky honey kind of sweet
sauce. I don't get
sauce.
It, and I can't compare it to anything else I've ever had. And I think that's why I get blown away by this Thai food so much, is because it's flavors all to itself. It's not, I can't be like, oh, this tastes like this or this tastes like that. It's very different, right?
People, Americans, by and large, don't understand Asian food at all. Right. Everything's Chinese food. Everything's an egg roll and egg foo young, you know? But,
Chicken and broccoli.
Chicken and broccoli. Yeah, right, exactly. Which is anything but Chinese. I don't even know how that ever came to... Because there was some soy sauce
in there.
That's it.
And it was made in a wok. There you go.
But they're all so different. And I'm actually, next week I'm going to Thailand. So I'm going to talk about it next...
Right.
After, a few days after next week's show, I'm going to talk about it next week. But Thailand, China, which actually I'm going to spend some time in China on the way there.
Nice.
Japan, which I went to last year.
I would love to go to Japan.
Korea. The foods are so phenomenal and they're so different.
Yeah.
So if you have not experienced Thai food and you think it's anything at all like other Asian types of food, don't just assume that. Go down to Thai Orchid on the corner of Sarah and 9th Street in Stroudsburg. Give them a call at 570-421-1717. They're open every day but Monday. Free food during lunchtime.
Yeah, it's free appetizers during lunch.
That's right. Check it out and then give us a call and let us know what you thought of it. This is Inside Dr. Herman's Head. We're going to take a short break and we'll be right back.
We're here with another of Dr. Herman's patients. Your name is...
I'm Tom the Turkey.
Tom, how are you?
I'm really in bad shape, Gary. Yeah,
talk to me. What happened?
Well, you know, I'm always looking over my shoulder, looking at some sort of farmer that's going to come and chop my head off for Thanksgiving. And it really hurts. And I'm afraid to stick my neck out, too, because you never know. Some kind of axe might come and lop my head off.
So you're experiencing...
A lot of neck pain, Gary. I'm really in pain because I'm always turning around. I'm always trying to fly. You ever see a turkey fly? It's not a pretty picture.
I can imagine not. How'd you hear about Dr. Herman?
Well, we always have the radio on in the barn in the morning, and I'm listening to his commercial, and I think maybe he can help me. So I finally made it to his office, and he put me up on the table, adjusted me, and I'm feeling better. That farmer ain't going to get me.
All right, turkey, give me the line.
I love my Dr. Herman.
I guess you're going to give thanks for Dr. Herman.
You had to mention Thanksgiving.
Call Dr. Herman at 424-LIFE.
Ask about their first graders programming robots. Parent Amanda Showers.
She's like, Mom, the robots that we use in school. We hook it up on the iPad and we type stuff in and it does what we tell it to do.
Teacher Tiffany Hogg.
The curiosity, I think, is important because if they're curious about something, they want to learn more.
Success starts here in my classroom. My daughter's success starts here.
To learn more about today's public schools, go to successstartshere.org. Sponsored by the Pennsylvania School Boards Association.
You're listening to Inside Dr. Herman's Head every Sunday night starting at 7 o'clock right here on Pocono 96.7. And now, back to the good doctor.
I had a funny... It's not even funny. Something happened.
It could be funny.
You're going to think it's funny.
Okay.
But I was just like, it's so par for the course.
What's going on?
I kind of as an aside, have you ever heard of Tommy Edison?
What's Edison?
Tommy Edison.
Tommy Edison. No.
Different. Tommy Edison has a YouTube channel that I suggest everybody check out sometime. It's called Tommy Edison XP. which is the Tommy Essen Experience.
Okay.
And this is a guy who, consequently, is actually 3 days younger than me. I just found that out just by coincidence. But he lives in Connecticut, and he's been blind since he's born.
All right.
And he does this fantastic channel on YouTube about being blind.
All right. Yeah.
People ask him all kinds of questions, and there are questions that either you may have thought of wondering about blind people, or that you... you know, that you would never have thought of asking. The people asking, and says, oh, and he explains everything there is about being blind, which is very, very interesting.
That, no, that's got to be interesting. I mean, it's since he was born, you said, so since it's all he's ever known, yeah.
Right, like the other day, somebody asked him a question. How did you handle being told or explained to that sight was a thing?
That's, you know? Yeah, that's true. I never would.
When you found out that not only other people would be able to do this thing that you can't do, but most of them, you know?
That's
so true. Really interesting. And he actually was on Howard Stern a few times.
Oh, really?
Yes, he was on Howard Stern's show. And I was watching a video on YouTube of him on Howard Stern's show. And one of the questions they asked him was when do you know you're finished wiping in the bathroom? Which is a great question to ask a blind person.
Question.
Okay. And
I'd like to know.
You know, then go and check out the video and you'll hear what he says.
I will.
Okay. And that's in preparation for my story. Because when I get up in the middle of the night to go to the bathroom,
okay,
I'm fine if it's number one. But if it's number two, you got to put some lights on.
Well, all right, yeah.
And if you put on light enough in the bathroom to be able to see what's going on, then you're screwing up your nightly cycle, your sleep cycle.
I get it. Yeah.
Okay. So I was very, very impressed when I saw a device hawked on TV.
Okay.
Actually, it wasn't because I don't have TV. It wasn't on TV that I saw it. It was a video from a commercial from TV.
Okay.
Called the Light Bowl. Have you seen this?
No, but I'm interested.
All righty.
Tell me more.
I'm going to tell you all about it right now. Oh, we have a caller?
We do have a caller.
Maybe it's the maker of the light bowl because I want to speak to that person. Thank you for calling inside Dr. Herman's Head.
Dr. Herman, you're like the Zagat of the local eateries and discussing the bathroom and why.
Oh, I didn't even get into the bathroom yet.
We've got a full moon. We've got a major moon coming tomorrow.
Yes.
We had a major election. We've had a few significant deaths this week. Just putting it out there. Maybe you want to discuss something else, you know. The great Leonard Cohen is speaking of rock and roll and writers.
Yes,
that's
right.
And Leon Russell died today. All these baby boomers, you know, who are just like, you know.
Yes, there are a lot of people that died. Who's calling, by the way? Who is this?
Oh, you know who this is.
This is
Carol?
This is Carol.
Of course it is.
Oh,
yeah.
Hey, Carol.
I didn't have any Mattachevich tonight, you know. I was working on Rainbow Mountain today, yeah.
Oh, maybe you want to have a glass or two before you call.
What?
Maybe you want to have a glass or two before you call. Actually, yes, you're right. You're right. This week we did have some very notable deaths. Leonard Cohen, Robert Vaughn died.
Oh, Mayor from Oakland, that was so sad. Yeah. You know what really killed? You want to know what really killed me this year?
Tell me.
Patty Duke. I love her.
Yeah,
oh my
but
God.
She was 110 years old.
You know?
Yeah.
She
had a family. So the list goes on.
She was a real good advocate for coming out of the closet with, you know, mental illness and putting it out there and, you know, destigmatizing it as much as we can, you know, even in the 21st century, you know. But,
yeah, I don't know if you know this, Carol. I actually keep a list of all the major deaths I have on my computer in my office. And
really?
Yes, and I actually announced them on the board in my office. This week it said Leonard Cohen, Robert Vaughn, and Our Way of Life.
Yeah. the death of Our Way of Life.
Did you hear about the White House turkey? This White House turkey was begging Obama to kill him because he doesn't want to go through it.
Yeah, begging for an early, you're right. That's funny.
Just do it now.
Oh, man. Hey, Carol.
Please take me.
Yeah. Yeah, well, thanks
anyway,
for calling, Carol.
I like your devoutness to the Thai garden. And anyway, yeah, you know, the better food we're exposed to, the healthier, you know. We hope it's healthy. But, you know,
oh, it's healthy.
Those
we need
horrible rumors about Asians. And, you know,
we definitely need more.
Animals, you know?
We definitely need some more good restaurants in the area, but I will eventually.
Yeah, we definitely need, you know, variety and Yeah, it's always good to have something good. And I will try the Thai gardens. I will.
Yes, well, the family's Thai orchid down at the next street in Sarah Street.
Let's just move away from being blind, which really must be horrible. And bathrooms.
Well, that's all he knows.
Days,
well, okay.
Dan.
You know what?
I'm going to deal with you.
You know what? Turn down for the next 5 minutes because you're not going to like this story.
Oh, okay.
Just 5 minutes. 5 minutes.
Then I have the option of shutting the radio, but at least you're still on the airwaves. That's what's annoying.
I'm still here.
You know what? Yeah. Radio is dying. It's sad.
Not as long as Big Show and I are here.
Yeah, no way. We're not going to let it die.
All right.
All right, Carol.
There you go.
Have a great weekend, sweetie.
All right. Beware the full moon. It's a super moon, too.
Yeah,
you know?
We're going to talk about that a little later.
All right, over and out. Bye.
Later.
She's sweet. She's looking for something interesting to say. Okay. We got another one.
Yeah,
right back to the phones. Welcome to Inside Dr. Herman's Head. Who's calling?
What the?
Hello.
Hello.
What the? Radio's not dying, Carol.
Carol's. I don't. She's not listening to the right station. I guess. I don't know.
Why don't you take a breath?
Radio's alive and well right here on Pocono 96.7.
That's right.
Dr. Herman is proving that. And what was that other guy? That,
I don't know. It's Jack from
you know the guy's name. He does the mornings. Anyway, and the girl that carries him.
Oh,
for God's
sake. Oh, right.
Radio's dying.
Barry and Alicia.
Barry and Alicia? Yeah, that's right.
Hey, that's a good morning show. You should listen to it every day.
Yeah, that's right. Carol made me ticked off, so I figured I'd call and let you know that I love your show.
Thank you so much. We love you too. And we love Carol and all our listeners equally.
Carol's all right, but the radio's not dying, Carol.
No. not as much as our as our federal government. So we'll be here to comment all the way through it.
All right. Thank you, Dr. Herman. Thank you, Big Show.
Thank you.
Dude, I'll see you later.
All right, bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
We love our radio proponents. Cool, let's go right back to it. This is Pocono 96.7 Inside Dr. Herman's Head. Who do we have?
Dr. Herman, it's JFB.
JFB, one call, my man. We're going to talk to you next week, Jeff, all right? All right, Jeff, catch you next week, my buddy.
Oh, follow
all right, the rules,
buddy.
One call per show.
I had to pull out my soprano there. Oh!
Oh!
Follow the rules.
You don't have your dice clay ready?
Well,
I have mine, but I'm not
going
to get to it. Anyway, I want to get to the story. The story was it affected me. So let's talk.
Let's get on this.
Okay, so I don't like to have my sleep cycle messed up.
Okay,
and I saw this light bulb device, and what it is it's a battery pack. Okay, it's about the half the size of a pack of cards.
Okay.
And it has a wire sticking out about 4.5-5 inches with a light on the end, an LED. And
I just had a vision, but that's cool. All right, go ahead.
You have to draw me a picture.
Talking about lights and toilet bowls and things, and I just
Well, this is okay.
Go ahead.
Now this thing has it's got to be very inexpensive to make. It's made in China, of course, and it's a very inexpensive device. And what happens is you can either select one of the 8 colors or you can have it cycle through the 8 colors, and it hangs on the outside of the toilet bowl, okay, on the rim of the bowl.
Okay.
Under the seat.
Okay.
Okay? Now, the seat, you're sitting on the seat, okay? When you open the door of the bathroom, it's motion activated.
Okay.
When you open the door of the bathroom, I guess this is for people who close their bathroom door when they're during the night.
Right.
If you have it open, whatever. You walk in the bathroom, that's motion too. And it senses the motion and it turns on the light. And it lights up the inside of the bowl.
Okay.
Which I guess is more to help you see where the bowl is.
I understand that.
But I think that the average person would definitely know where that toilet bowl is, even if they were completely blind.
I got a nightlight in my bathroom, man. I can see that. You know what I mean?
Exactly.
Yeah.
But, I was getting it hoping that it would be bright enough to help me out if I was getting busy in there and needed some more light.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm talking about?
Yeah, okay. I hear you.
So I ordered this thing, and... across from China. I ordered it on Amazon.
Okay.
And there was actually
It came from China.
It was so good that somebody brought it all the way here from China.
There we go.
Okay? Now, next week I'll be in China, so maybe I can pick up my own, you know, when I'm there. But I ordered it. It took 3 weeks to get here.
All right.
Okay? Excuse me. As a matter of fact, I found a company. They all make the same one. It's the same one.
Okay.
Same exact unit. And this one had two-pack for the same price, close to the same price.
Yeah, put one in each bathroom.
So I ordered 3 2-packs, which would be 6 units.
3 2-packs?
3 2-packs, because I have a lot of toilets in my house. I have 5 toilets in my house.
Seriously?
Yeah.
I did not know this.
I have 5 toilets. I think I have 5.
And then you got one for the office?
2, 3, 4, 5, yes. And I got one. No, I just thought, one for my mother if she wanted.
Oh, there you go. Okay. Mom needs one.
So, it took 3 weeks to get there, and I got it just on Friday, 2 days ago. Yesterday, I opened it up, and I'm reading the instructions, and it says, first it says, adjust the wire to be the right length to hook over the side of the bowl, but the wire is not adjustable at all.
Okay.
It's bendable, but not adjustable. So, it tells you to put batteries, three AAA batteries in it,
mm-hmm.
close the battery cover, and you hang it on the edge of the bowl. You bend the light over.
Yeah, you bend
so,
it over,
okay,
and
right.
it just hangs in there.
And the light went on, and it changed to the 8 different colors and whatever, and I stopped.
Different colors.
It actually glows red to blue to green to white to purple.
It changes while it's on disco ball.
Yeah.
Oh, no way.
Very, very colorful.
Disco bowl. That's nice.
Now, it says hook it on the bowl. Preferably in a place where I can pick up the motion of people coming into the room.
Okay.
Which, in my bathroom, is directly opposite the toilet, so I put it on the front of the toilet bowl.
Okay.
Okay. In the pictures, it's on the side of the bowl. But it's said to put it where the picture the most...
Yeah, put it where you're going to put it. Put it in the front.
So I was on the toilet bowl, and I was doing my business in the bathroom. And I realized that it was not enough light for me to do what I was hoping it would be enough light for me to do.
Okay.
All right, whatever. And but I put on the lights in the bathroom and I did what I had to do, and you know when you, like summertime especially, your skin tends to sweat a little bit. Or sometimes it sticks to plastic.
I know about sweat, man.
Okay.
Yeah.
When I go to stand up,
big guy.
And my skin lifted up the seat just a little bit.
Okay. Yeah, go on, please.
It lifted it up just enough for this brand new device that I waited almost a month for. No, you have to understand something. You have to understand that the battery pack, the whole weight of the 95% of the weight is hanging outside the bowl.
I got you, yeah.
So if it's going to unhook and fall,
it should go out.
It should fall out. It did not. It went right in. And for a second, just for a split second, I was able to see everything that was going on in that bowl in vivid green. Vivid, bright, glowing ecto green.
Ecto bowl.
But only for a split second, because the device is not meant to be submerged in water, and everything went out.
I was reaching in there.
I don't generally keep a pair of gloves in the bathroom, surgical gloves in the bathroom. Now, you can't flush the bowl.
No, you gotta get in there.
So for just about 10 seconds, I just looked at it, just stared into the darkness that used to be very green and very pretty. I stared in the darkness and I said to myself, really? All the way from China? Oh, I'm sorry. Did I mention that only 3 of them came in the mail? I didn't get 6. I got 3. Where they said 2-pack, it wasn't a 2-pack. They changed the listing afterward because somebody said it's not a 2-pack. It's only a 1.
Have fun calling that customer service.
Well, I sent them an email. I'm waiting to hear from them, and I will. An update will be forthcoming when I hear from them. But I expect to hear any minute now because they're middle of the night, China.
You're gonna get it while you're sleeping.
But yes, I had to go and find myself a glove of surgical tensile strength. and I had to go searching down into the bowl so that I wouldn't clog up my entire septic system. And of course, the thing is completely destroyed because it shorted out.
Yeah, it's done. Yeah, yeah.
It was 5 minutes out of the box.
Maybe that's why they're trying to sell you more than one, because every time you're going to go, one's going to drop in there.
But it's just like, I don't even know what the mechanism of, you know, of events happened to cause this thing to fall into the bowl. But that's what happened. Yeah, first use, 2 minutes out of the box.
That's great.
And I just kind of stood there and I kind of laughed like Tom Hanks in Money Pit when the bathtub fell through the floor. I was like, ha ha, nah. Of course. And then I had a shower and scrub my hands.
Yeah, I was just going to say, I mean, if Elisa's listening, hey, you might want to bring some hand sanitizer and wipes tomorrow for your keyboard and microphone.
Oh, I'm all over your computer, Elisa.
You now know where Dr. Herman's hands have been.
What does this microphone feel like? Oh. Don't put the microphone there.
Oh, my God.
So I will let you know what happens with that. But
yeah,
but
I guess I'm going to need the follow-up on that.
Because I'm not going to recommend the light bulb to people.
Just the fact that it came straight from China, you had to email China, and if you get on the phone with them, I want to know what happens.
Oh, man. I'm going to send them a picture. I'm going to send them a reenactment. I put the video on the
The worst part about it is I know your feeling. I mean, mine was a little bit worse because I did that with a phone. And it was like I was wearing a shirt like this, you know, with the front pocket.
Right.
Had the phone in the pocket.
Oh, and you bent over?
Just turned around, bent over, and bloop, right in there. Yeah.
I keep my phone far away from the toilet because I know too many people that have deep-sixed it. And actually, I'm curious about this. I want to know what percentage of people, when they drop their phone in the toilet. My daughter Danielle did it about half a dozen times.
Half a dozen.
She's gone through about half a dozen phones. Jeez. Just from dropping a toilet alone. But, excuse me, I want to know from our callers, if you've dropped your phone in the toilet, was it with the toilet water clean or not clean? I'm just curious to know how many people, you know, experienced that. And because with me, it would never happen when it was clean. I know that. But, okay, let's take another trip to Thai Orchid.
Let's do it.
And I did want to talk about my favorite thing on the menu, which I get only on special occasions.
Special occasion.
Yeah.
Isn't every time a Thai orchid a special occasion?
Every time is special, but not necessarily an occasion.
Okay.
But when you know it's a big deal when I order the crispy duck.
Oh, that sounds so good, man.
You get a half a duck, and it's so crispy. And it's got an incredible sauce that comes with it, a tamarind sauce, but you can get it with any of the other sauces they have if you have a sauce that you like best. Comes with some really good vegetables on the side. But what Tanya puts into it, and it's not actually on the menu, it's kind of a surprise, is a deep-fried hard-boiled egg.
Whoa!
With a crispy coating to it.
That's awesome.
Very,
that
very good.
Incredible.
But the duck is fabulous. It's so crispy. And luckily, I've trained myself to only eat half of it at a sitting, so I save half for the next day. So it's 2 days of crispy duck in a row. Make me very happy.
Yeah, man.
It's the most special thing on the menu to me. Let me know if you like it. Go down and try it. Thai Orchid, 570-421-1717, corner of Sarah Street and 9th Street. Take another break. We'll be right back.
It's a bingo benefit for Monroe County Special Olympics. Come out and play bingo every Sunday and Tuesday at the CLU Social Club located at 265 South Cortland Street in East Stroudsburg. Proceeds are benefiting Monroe County Special Olympics. More information, call 570-798-SOMC.
You're listening to Inside Dr. Herman's Head every Sunday night starting at 7 o'clock right here on Pocono 96.7. And now, back to the good doctor.
I kind of like hearing the old song once in a while.
I am so happy that we used it for the return music.
Yeah, we still get it.
And because, you know, even if we don't use it now, I don't feel bad about not using it for the theme.
Right.
Because we still hear it every show. So, all right. Well, I barely got a chance to take a breath on that break. But
yeah, I know. That was quick.
That's all right.
That's what we had lined up. So.
We have no shortage of things to talk about. Have you noticed Maybe. I've always felt this way a long time. I know you have, because you're very astute.
Get out of here. There
isn't a lot that I talk about that you aren't at least somewhat aware of. But I've always thought this, it's occurred to me lately especially, the seasons. You know, people say they love living in this area because we have all four seasons.
And Frankie Valli. Zing. All right, go ahead.
That was really good. You were right there on that one.
Oh, yeah.
But I'm not going to feel bad about you getting the better joke there because big girls don't cry.
No, that's true.
But
you just call yourself a girl, but that's great.
I'm not the first one, believe me. We have all four seasons here, but we don't have long enough seasons. I think the seasons should be longer, and I know that we don't have any control over the seasons. I know that the seasons come and go based on the orbit of the Earth around the sun and blah, 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 but I'm hoping that President Trump can do something about that. He can make the seasons even more bigger and better.
Listen, he's here to make the seasons great again, and it will happen.
He'll make them more seasony than they ever were before.
You know, if he can't make it happen, it was rigged, and that was it.
Hillary destroyed the seasons. Obama destroyed the seasons. No, but I was noticing today because it came time to put our outdoor furniture away.
Okay.
To put my beloved hammock away.
Ah, hammocks are great.
To cover up the things outside that stay outside, like my jet skis, you know, that kind of thing.
Look at you, jet skis showing off.
I didn't get a chance to use them this year at all. Uh-huh. They sat and baked in the sun, which is not a good thing.
Boo.
But in any event, you know, you have to. It seems like we're making our seasonal changes so fast. Like our clothes, the winter clothes come out, the summer clothes go away, and we just took the summer clothes out.
I know.
The patio furniture has to come out, then it's got to go away. We got this got to go away, that with it. It's in and out.
It was August, and we had Halloween stuff in the stores, and as soon as Halloween ended, Christmas hits.
Right.
You know, I mean, and everybody complains about it every year, but it is what it is. But I mean, the seasons seriously themselves have been. I know, like you said, like we can't change that. It's the Earth,
right? But that's the thing. I was thinking, now that we're getting closer to the possibility of living on other planets, Mars, which is further away, right? It's the next planet away from the sun. Yeah, has not, longer seasons.
Yeah. I'm not the astronomer, but...
Well, Mercury's on the inside, then Venus, then Earth, then Mars. Okay. So Mars has longer seasons than we have. We go around the Earth in 365... Around the sun, rather, in 365 days.
Yeah.
It takes, I think, two and a half times that for Mars to do it. So their seasons are going to be double or a little bit longer than each one. And this way, I don't have to rake the leaves every 3 months. I can wait 6 or 7 months.
I don't think you're raking any leaves on Mars.
When we go to Mars, there will be leaves.
There will be.
I will make sure they're leaves. They'll be the best leaves that you ever saw, and you'll have the best rakes to rake them.
You're going to have the best lawn. Oh, you've never seen a lawn so good. You're going to have such a good lawn.
Oh, it's good. It's, and not just it's small. It's going to be big. Big.
Huge.
The best. Huge.
Huge lawn.
Are we doing Bernie now or doing Trump?
No, that was a mix of both.
All right. Well, that's
good. I think something in there.
I have time for this. I have time for this. My mother.
Moms, yeah.
My mother. On election day, because I don't have TV and I was interested in the election and wanted to watch it live.
I streamed it because I don't have TV either. Yeah.
Well, my mother is getting ready to move and she needed my help packing things. So I drove down. She lives about 100 miles away. So I drove down into New Jersey to help her pack. Just a little bit of background. My mother has always had chihuahuas. She loves little chihuahuas.
Mm-hmm.
She's had Taco Bell dog. Yeah, many over the years, little ones, big ones, and the one that she had up until recently, what this story is about, was about 14 years old, and had gotten very sick, had some heart problems, and started to retain water, looked like a little balloon,
kind of waddling
around the house. The dog was about 6 pounds and ballooned up to about double that just from liquid. The dog was very, very, very sick, and back in September, right around the beginning of September, I got her a new dog, a little puppy. It's the smallest chihuahua she's ever had. It was 1.5 pounds. And it won't get any bigger than about 3.5 pounds. It's a, the tiniest little, cutest little thing you've ever seen. Actually, it's really ugly, but it's cute the way it moves and
real
the way
ugly,
it's a little
shivering little.
Yeah, it's a
rat.
Little, you know, but very, very friendly. It's a very sweet little dog. And her other dog wasn't happy with having it around. Of course, the vet said right. It would help the other dog to have a companion. It did not. The
it
other
didn't
dog was
at
very,
all.
Very upset. And we were driving down. I was driving down election morning and to help her to spend the day down there. And I gave her a call to let her know I was coming. And she said the dog had a very bad night. And I said, oh, I know how this is going to work. The dog's going to die on the day I'm going down there. Sure enough. Well, about half an hour later, I'm only halfway down the trip. She called me up. She said the dog came in from the other room, laid down on her lap, took a deep breath, peed all over the place, and then died.
Ugh.
Right in her lap. So she was very, very, very sad.
Yeah.
But at least she had the new one that she's had for a couple of months. They keep her company, and she felt really bad about
right.
it.
Right. But, yeah, that's a hard way to go right there.
Yeah, it was very hard. She was very upset, and I said, well, I'll be down there in a little bit. And, you know, and I helped her feel better. We took her out to lunch. This
probably
and that.
Nice for the dog, though.
Well, the dog had to go. The dog was very sick.
But I mean, like, nice. You know, he came over, sat on her.
Well, she, yeah. I said, that's the best way she could have gone.
That's what I'm saying.
She went in your lap, and, you know, her head was resting on your arm, and she felt loved, and that's the best way to go. You know what?
Comfortable and just let it go.
That's the best way for all of us to go.
Yeah.
You know, crawl into the arms of somebody you love and then go. But make sure you pee all over them first.
Well, yeah.
Okay.
Evacuate and then.
I love you, and I know that you're here for me. And I. But as a last gesture, anything you ever did that really got me upset, this is for you. So I told her. Oh, so she says to me, she said I called the vet, and the vet said that to cremate the dog would cost $80.
Okay.
She said, but she said it doesn't. I don't really need to do that. She said you live up in the wilderness, up in the Poconos.
Yeah. Well,
I kind of live in the wilderness.
Yeah.
And she said, could you bury her on your property? And
yeah,
I said, sure. I said I could do that. That's
no
problem. Which led me, as an aside, to wonder about how it's possible that we can bury animals on our property without any special, you know, small animals like this or whatever, your canary, your little dog, whatever, even your big dog, you know, without a special permit.
Mm-hmm.
But people, no good.
Yeah.
Interesting. But anyway, so she asked me if I could bury her. I said, sure. I said, wrap her up in a towel, put her in a box, and I'll bring her back with me. Well, that night, just to, you know, shorten this thing up a little bit, I brought her all the way back to the Poconos.
Mm-hmm.
And I realized that the ground, it was surprising to me because it hasn't really been that cold, the ground was pretty firm. And my legs aren't what they used to be, and you'd have to really, you know, push this shovel down into the ground.
Yeah,
I could have done it, but I said to her, oh, you know, the ground is harder than I thought or whatever. And it was raining the next day, you know, and I said, it's raining all day today, and I just, so it's all muddy. And so she said,
all right, so this dog's sitting there?
The dog was sitting in my garage, you know, and well, whatever. So I said to her, I said, I'm running out of time to do something with this dog. I said, which is, she says, well, why don't you call around to the different vets in your area, find out how much it is to cremate it, and have them cremate it. I said, now this is my project.
Yeah. Just passed it on to you.
It's my project.
I don't feel like spending $80. Maybe Jan will want to go and do that.
Oh my gosh. So, so I found a burning pit area that had been used for a burning pit where most of what was there was like old ash.
Yeah.
So it wasn't like compacted, you know,
you
dirt and
yourself?
Shale. Yeah. So I found the spot and I buried the dog. Oh, she said, but originally when she said, you know, when I left that night at her house and I said I was going to bury the dog the next day, she said, now your cousin buried a cat on her property. She's a farm in Jersey.
Mm-hmm.
She buried a cat. She didn't bury it deep enough and a wolf got it that night. So make sure you bury it deep enough.
Well,
I said, is 6 feet good? I don't know what,
yeah.
you know? Really?
Yeah.
I don't have a backhoe at my house. So I'm not going to. So I, you know, I buried it about a foot deep enough to, you know.
Get a little 2 foot coffin so that the wolf can't break in. And
so the next day she says, well, did you cremate it? Did you bury it? I said, it's taken care of.
Yeah.
Just, it's good.
It's taken care of, Ma.
The dog's not going to. If it turns into a dog zombie, it's not going to come back.
Yeah, I mean, you're not a. It's not like Pet Cemetery. Your house isn't on some Indian burial ground, is it? That,
I wouldn't know.
You know.
Actually, you know what? I wouldn't be surprised because there is a wall next to my property, my border on my property, that was built during the Civil War. So I could have a burial property.
Man, you know, we got all these Indian grounds around here, all these Native American.
Why is it got to be Indians? Why can't it be you know, circus performers. Maybe it's a circus. Circus performers.
It's a Ringling Brothers Barnum and Bailey Cemetery.
Could be
for the animals.
Could be. I don't know. I'm out in the wilderness. Anything's possible.
Out in the wilderness. With
Buffalo Bills. There. I don't know. Whatever. You know what? The end of the show creeps up on me so fast.
It does creep up quick.
There was more to that story, and there I have so many things. I just want you people to know I prepare a lot more than I have time for. So if anybody is still interested in those tickets, we'll be here for about another 5 or 10 minutes. You can give us a call. The tickets for Gorilla Grove or for Alive 75 on Saturday night at the Sherman. Let's see. La, la, la. I'd like to thank all my callers.
Yes.
JFB. Thank you for your first call, but not your second.
Yeah. Listen to the rules, man.
That's the rules, dude. Carol, thank you so much always for calling.
Yeah,
we really appreciate it.
It's been a while.
And our mystery morning jock for calling in. Thank you very much, Barry.
Yeah, well, speaking of that.
Well, we got another call?
Yeah, we do.
Let's get it. Welcome to the Inside Dr. Herman's Head.
Yeah, this is JFB.
JFB, we're going to talk to you, I guess, next week. Okay, that was call number three.
Yeah, come on, man.
JFB, thank you very much for trying the third call. JFB, you can now officially call us on our next live show after our break, which will be December 11th.
It's December 11th.
Okay, December 11th for JFB. That's officially, that's the next time you can call in.
Yeah, we're gonna have to do the rules every show, and I'm going to have to start playing that Mr. T thing every
Yeah, every I know, again. I know. Yeah. Mr. JFB.
Yeah.
Bit of a fool. Oh, man. Well, thanks again to all of our callers. This is Inside Dr. Herman's Head. It's spoken on 96.7. I'd like to also thank the true reincarnation of Elvis Presley, Big Show Larson.
Yes. Thank you. Thank you very much. It's true. I told you, man. I was born the year he died. It's not a coincidence.
I'm starting to believe that there's something to it.
There is something to it.
I'm going to do some research on that. One more week for our Thanksgiving logo contest. Check it out on Facebook, where you can like us and leave all kinds of comments about the show. Carol, you can talk about how you don't like talking about listening to me talk about the toilet. You can check out all of our old shows on YouTube. La la la. Oh yes, and check it out tomorrow night. Carol was right. It's a supersized, super full moon.
Yeah,
the closest it has been in your lifetime, probably.
The super ultra mega dope fresh sized moon.
It depends on how old you are. If you've seen it before, the last one happened in we don't want to have that written down. 1948.
Wow.
And the next one will happen in 2034. So if you're planning on being around for the next 18 years, you can see another one. But I implore you to get out tomorrow night and check it out. Thanks so much for listening to our show. We really appreciate and love every single one of you. In honor of the supersized moon and my favorite male singer of all time, it's the Nat King Cole.
Nice.
Come and take a trip in my rocket ship. We'll have a lovely afternoon. Kiss the world goodbye, and away we fly. Destination moon. Travel fast as light till we're lost from sight. The earth is like a toy balloon. What a thrill you get riding on a jet. Destination moon. We'll go up, 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 straight to the moon we two. High in the starry blue, I'll be out of this world with you. So away we steal in a space mobile, a supersonic honeymoon. Leave your cares below, pull the switch, let's go. Destination moon. Destination moon. Destination moon. There once was a time when the colorful thing to do was to call for a date on a bicycle built for two.
But cars and trains and even planes all hate. Now the time is due to call for you in the modern atomic way. We'll go up, 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 straight to the moon we two. High in the starry blue, I'll be out of this world with you. So away we steal in a space mobile, a supersonic honeymoon. Leave your cares below, pull the switch, let's go. Destination.